peer, Lord Jones, Digby Jones to many of us. Thank you for coming on the programme. Is it something that you think this will be acceptable not only to the Parliament here, but also to the European Union? Because at the moment, the mood music suggests not.
Yeah, there are three parties in this, aren't there? There's the European Union, there's that place, and there is, are the people. And I think the people have had enough around the country, little businesses, big businesses, Remainers, Brexiteers, they've all had enough. And they want the 650 in that place to turn around and say, stop all this and stop telling us what you don't want and start telling us what you do. I think from a Conservative Party point of view, I think this will be sufficient to bring all but the really two or three diehards out of the European Reform Group and into the Tory mainstream to vote for it. I think the 21 who crossed the chamber when they were expelled for before prorogation, I think they'll come back, and therefore he can work that through, provided Europe agree. And the one thing that's been a symptom, it's been a characteristic of the Europe's attitude to all of this. They are terrified of being blamed. They do not want anybody to say that they are the cause of the problem. They've been trying to shift the blame onto the United Kingdom for years.
Well, how have they done that?
Well, for a start, they've just said no, no, no. And they've just watched the UK give in, give in, give in, write a bigger cheque, agree to this and that.
Hang on a minute. Look,
by the way,
Lord Jones.
I'm not for a minute saying that that is Europe's fault. What I'm saying is it's a characteristic that they don't want to be blamed.
But hang on. There was a deal that went through Parliament that had been agreed, a withdrawal agreement, Theresa May's deal, that failed to get through the Parliament in this country three times. We went no three times. They haven't.
No. I'm not arguing with the facts of the matter. What I'm saying is they've never wanted to be blamed. And we're now looking at something where I think those three parties, the country out there, the bubble here, and then Europe, they all don't want to be the blockage anymore. And I think Europe will probably, But I think probably the European Union will not want to be seen to be the final blockage. And at some point, either side of the summit of all the European leaders, I think they'll agree to this.
And the suspicion is that that is exactly the Prime Minister's strategy, that he knows this is a deal that the EU would not go for, and that he can do exactly what you're saying and blame the EU.
I actually don't believe that's why he's doing it. There's a subtle distinction here. Has he decided to do this so he shows up Europe as the blockage, and then he can say they're stopping all this, and on that basis I'm off to the country as the people's champion? I don't think he's done that at all. But I do think the strategy that says, I'm going to put Europe into a place where they are going to have to say yes, I agree with you, I think that is a strategy. But he's doing it for the reason of getting the deal through there. He's not doing it for the reason for being able to be the people's champion against Europe.
You're seen as an authority on business with your background, and we've been hearing from businesses in Northern Ireland who are simply saying, how on earth would these proposals work? If you don't have a border, in effect a hard border with customs posts there, but you have to have infrastructure somewhere, what does that mean? How does that work in practice?
Well, I think on the first point, loads of small businesswomen and businessmen all over the country, and bigger businesses actually, what they want is certainty. They've had enough. They're not investing. Why? Because they need to know. They need to touch the bottom of the pool we're all swimming in, and then they will commit, whether it's good or bad news. Northern Ireland, special issue, and the practical point of following through what you've just said, the practical application of the agreement or the draft agreement, I think Northern Ireland businesses have an issue, which is prove to us it can work in practice. I don't think they're going around saying this is rubbish. I think they're actually understanding why it's going to happen, but it needs to win its spurs in the practical application. And what I would say to that is, and I'd make this plea to all politicians, you know, trust business more. Business are pretty good at being innovative and getting things done. Business is pretty good from small to large at ensuring things get worked through. That's how businesses make money so often. And I just say to politicians, with great respect, so many of them wouldn't understand their business if it got up and bit them. I would just say to them, will you just for once let the business women and businessmen of Northern Ireland help that work, and don't sit back and go, oh, it's not going to work. And I would say, let businesses make this agreement happen, whether it's in Northern Ireland or whether it's in the rest of the UK.
The difficulty with that argument, I let money do the talking in effect.
That's not what I said.
But it is, really.
No, that's unfair, because what you're therefore saying is let profit do the talking. I've not said that at all. What I've said is business men and women are innovative people. They find ways round things. They understand the nuances of getting things done. And on that basis, their talent and their expertise and their time, they can actually add a lot of value to this getting it done and making this agreement work. If the byproduct is that men and women in this country are employed, generate profit, pay tax and build schools and hospitals, what on earth is wrong with that? But don't think they'd be doing it just for money. That's unfair.
If we're looking at the backstop, which does seem a bit to always, as it has been, at the heart of disquiet over all this, there are businesses who are going to say, well, that's all very well. We've had easy trade between North and South. And now this proposal is suggesting not one, but two borders in effect.
And your point is?
Well, if I was running a business, that would complicate things. That would be exactly what I would be afraid of, which is more red tape, more bureaucracy, more difficulty and understanding.
Good point. I think it does create more bureaucracy and red tape, but there would be a way through that as it worked out. There would be a way in which, from checks on trucks before they leave, after they've arrived, whether they're sealed on the way through, there'll be loads of ways you can make this work. But prima facie, you're right, there is more, but I think they'd accept more now than this thing not happening at all.
Lord Jones, it's good to talk to you. Thank you very much for your time this afternoon.
My pleasure.